just hired somebody to work on system optimization. Okay. Our system is getting so large now that we need to keep track of a lot more things. Other things that we do is our regulated sampling program. We do microbiological samples weekly, as per our regulations. We check our physical parameters and also chemical. Through that, we take raw samples, so we take water before we even treat it. We test that to see if there's anything in it to start with. We check it after we've treated it. We take samples out in the distribution system at various sites. And we take grab samples, just random, anywhere. Okay? If there's a customer complaint about their water and we go to their site, we'll take a grab sample. And we'll do a test right there on the site for chlorine, turbidity if we need to. And we can get a pretty good idea right then what the situation might be.
What is turbidity again?
Turbidity is just the clarity of the water, of what's in the water.
It's not clear.
Non-dissolved.
Could be non-dissolved solids.
Yeah. So when it comes out cloudy, it could be
also a solid too. A solid could be a turbidity.
When you're a scuba diver, you know about turbidity because you can't see a thing.
But our turbidity in the city's groundwater system is anywhere from 0.2, maybe 0.7 NTUs. Which is
pretty good.
Nothing.
Very good.
The lowest you can read on a turbidity meter, I think, is 0.0 or 0.18. That's, yeah.
So if there's air in the lines, does that make it
that
cloudy
will,
as
it
well?
Will, it will show up, yes. Okay. You could have dissolved gases in there. It could be air, it could be, you know, if a pump is cavitating, mm-hmm. or if the well is starting to lose its performance and it's still pumping out the same amount of water and it draws the aquifer level down to where the screen is, and it can suck in a little bit of air and it will give you a little bit of
cloudiness.
Okay. But we do check for that every day on rounds. There's a perfusion system. Our objectives are to deliver adequate quantities of water at sufficient pressure at all times under continually changing conditions, while at the same time protecting the water quality. Okay. So seasonally, our water flow demands fluctuate, and at times of fire, we need to supply adequate supply of water for the fire department. Okay. The pipes in the city of Barrie, our distribution crews, they operate and they maintain almost 600 kilometers of transmission and distribution piping. There's about 5,000 valves in the system, and they all have to be checked once a year. There are approximately 3,800 hydrants that also need to be checked every year. And they also look after service laterals, and the customer service people look after meters.
What's a service lateral?
That's the line that comes from the street to your house. Okay, they go as far as what's called a curb box.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then the curb box in is your responsibility. If you have a problem with your water pressure or supply, customer service will come out into your house and check the incoming line coming into your house. Usually they can give it a quick flush and restore your service, right? But if it is from the curb box in, it is your responsibility to repair. Okay. But if it's from the curb box out to the street, then the city looks after it.
Sometimes
it's a demarcation point.
Not metal.
That's right. That's kind of like the demarcation point.
Sometimes tree roots get into the line.
More in sewers than in water pipe. The water pipe is usually a continuous pipe. So if it got into your pipe, then you've got big issues.
Mm-hmm.
You got bigger issues. Okay, but it's usually copper, except for earlier houses built before. Say around like 1930, 1940.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, most pipes before then could be galvanized, and as I'll get into with the customer service, there is what's called a lead program, but I'll get into that a little bit later. For the distribution system, we operate using what's called pressure principles, We use the topography of this area to give the system pressures to your house. Okay. Now, and that's what we call as an open system. A closed system is if it's just a pump pushing into a pipe, and that's it. There's no reservoir at the end. There's no open tank. Okay. Right now, the only time we go into a closed system is if we shut down an elevator. When they put the overpass in, it'll be quite busy.
Yeah.
In the future. Okay. So currently, as I said, there's five major zones in the city, and they're all interconnected with valves. We do have the ability to pump from one area to, or run water from one area to another. And we also have little mini zones that are controlled by what we call pressure regulating valves. Okay. They're in because of the topography of the land. And in that certain area, if we just used gravity, the pressure would be too high. So we had to reduce the pressure. Okay?
Too high?
In some areas, because your hot water tank has a pressure relief valve that will go at 150 psi. So if we try giving you 150 psi in your house, your hot water tank would blow off the vent, and that would fill your basement.
Wow.
So we try and maintain no higher than around 100.
Oh.
Okay.
Interesting.
Where will the servicing for the new annex area come from?
Servicing, the supply of water?
The water, yeah.
That will come from the surface water plant. That's one of the reasons for the plant.
Okay.
Okay. As I said, right now we're fed from the groundwater system, and this year we will feed that area, the two pressure zones in the south, with the surface water treatment plant. And that'll provide us reserve quantities and pressures, and we also maintain that with our towers and reservoirs in the south end.
So does that mean that the underground aquifers are getting empty? That
no.
You can't?
No.
Why the change from one to the other?
The basic change is the size of the city. The aquifer has a limit as to what you can pump out of it.
Well, that's what I meant, yeah.
And right now, we're not there yet, but we're getting close.
So how do you measure something like that?
We've done studies in the 1990s. We did a study in the, I think there was an earlier one in the early 2000s. There was another one done in the early 1990s. I think there's been about three studies done in which we've had our well drillers that do our well drilling for the groundwater. They also have some hydrologists on staff, and we did some studies back then, and we pumped all our wells at a constant rate over a period of time, and from that they could develop what's called our yield
mm-hmm.
from our aquifer
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and forecasted when they projected we would reach our maximum. Okay,
wouldn't you say that the lake is connected to those aquifers for some way?
It is, but it's not the way that you think. Right now, the flow of the aquifer actually comes from the west. Our main aquifer is in this area.
Mm-hmm.
It actually loops in this kind of area and spreads out. And the water flow comes from the west to the east. And actually, the divers that have been down in here swimming, the wrecks and that, they've noticed like a boil, which basically indicates that the water is coming this way. There's like an underground spring in the bottom of the lake.
Cool.
Okay. So we know the water flow is this direction. We actually have four wells here on site on the lakeshore. And during this time of year, if we shut these wells down for a period of time, the water table actually goes above grade. Okay. So if we have these wells that are especially designed that they're capped, so that water doesn't flow out of them when we're not using them, and we have a low demand period. So that just indicates that the hydraulic pressures from the west and from the topography is actually pushing down onto the bay, and there's quite a volume of water there.
Mm-hmm.
Some people think that this may have had an extensive drilling program and lots of money, and you keep drilling. May find that it loops up to Georgia Bay. They think there's a from the glacial period that may be an old underground river.
Okay.
Some people call the Algonquin River.
Mm-hmm.
So that's
okay.
Just
interesting.
Are we connected to the Oro Moraine, or we're separate from it?
We don't have a link to it that we know of. We have in this area in the north, we have two well sites here, and we do know there's an aquifer in this area that we think ties in over here, over to another well site here at Brown Lake. And we think there's an aquifer in this area that's separate from this one. Okay? And we have a third one down in this area. It's just like a little fender aquifer down here that we stopped using. We haven't connected to here. There used to be another well site out here that they used to use back in the Cold War to supply Edgar, the old military base by Horseshoe Valley. There used to be a couple of wells here that used to pump all the way to Horseshoe Valley.
So site 41, if it had been activated, would have polluted some of this water, perhaps? If you say that it might go all the way over
there. Here's the spot. You're
no, right. It's just it's just knowing where Elmville is and where site 41 is and where they perceive that this aquifer comes from. You'd have to do a lot of...
Yeah, you couldn't say for sure.
You could,
of course.
It would be hard-pressed to link it.
Yeah.
It would be hard-pressed to link it. Just because of the distances and the topography of the land and that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And just looking at the topography and how the glacial period kind of gouged out the area, I'd be kind of hard-pressed.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That's kind of like in the Oro Lake area,
but
so
it goes to show you that there's an awful lot of stuff going on underground that we don't know about.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah,
and there's until you have the funding
to do
a lot of studies and a lot of drilling in it, which is expensive. And
I know.
At 0.07 cents a liter.
Oh yeah.
You're gonna be hard pressed to find people wanting to put out that money to find it. So.
Yeah. Hey.
Right. We'll just take the risk anyhow. And
No, I wouldn't say that, but it's just that...
Site 41 came close to coming alive, but it's still there.
Maintain it through a flushing swabbing program, so that we try and make sure that the water that's at the end point is not aged, is I guess a word I would use. We try and keep it that from the time we produce it to the time it gets to the customer, we try and keep it within roughly a 3-day window.
Cool.
Okay? We don't try and let it sit out there for a long period of time.
Mm-hmm. Stagnant water.
Yeah, we just want to keep it moving. Okay? As long as we keep it moving, it's better for us.
Yeah.
If it sits, then the iron and manganese and that will start to precipitate out of the pipe. Even though we sequestered it,
mm-hmm.
it will go down. So in the summertime, or actually starting in April, you'll start seeing our crews going out there on the extensive program. They do some maintenance stuff right now because of the freezing and that. But about end of March, April, they'll kick into gear. And depending on the area that we're targeting at that time period, you'll probably see a couple of trucks by hydrants, one in front of the other. And they'll be leapfrogging as they go along the system, and they'll be flushing that section of pipe out, trying to clear out anything that's in there. And usually if we're in your area or whatever, the people at the desks, they know about it, so if your water is discolored for a certain period of time, it's kind of because we created it as we're trying to clean it out. It's usually about running your water 15 minutes, mm-hmm. clears it out, and you're ready to go again. Okay. It's very limited, but it's... And our swabbing program is getting more and more... We're expanding it every year, so that we're trying to not only just try and use water to go through, we're also using mechanical means of going through,